Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and power and power and glory and glory.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
And glory. Hallelujah. Forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Operating in your greatness. That's the title today. Operating in your greatness. You see, beloved, everyone has a greatness about themselves. But what we think what greatness is and what God thinks what greatness is two different lights. You see, as human beings, we equate greatness with being on the top of our game, being the fastest person, doing the greatest things. I'm number one in this thing. Being known and recognized. Being number one on the job. Making a last minute big shot in that big game. Playing on the big stage in front of millions of people that are screaming your name. Operating in your greatness. But in God's eyes, greatness is viewed a little bit different. In God's eyes, your greatness isn't walking in the same direction that everybody else is walking. Greatness isn't pleasing people's needs and changing your direction from the Lord, but what he's given you. Your greatness isn't saying soothing words to keep the seats full in the church. It isn't people believing in you and trusting in who God has called you to be. You see, my wife can sing, beloved. She has a few opportunities to be on sing-off contests. You know, but hasn't made it on that big stage, on the TV shows yet. But that doesn't mean that she can't sing or wouldn't do good in the contest. But God is viewing her greatness in a different light. See, other areas of her life, by being with these young women and prophetically building them up to be women of God that they're calling them to be, that's how God is viewing her greatness. I'm talking about greatness right now.
Come on now.
Your greatness isn't walking in the, like I said, in the same direction as everybody else. Your greatness isn't pleasing the people. It isn't saying those soothing words that we would like to hear or say. Greatness. I'm talking about greatness.
Amen.
See, God uses the least of us, beloved, to bring the best out of us. Let me say that again. He uses the least of us to bring the best out of us. You see, in two situations, the Apostle Paul had to go against the grain to keep the truth of the Lord and protect it and stand up for its right. You see, him and Barnabas had a sharp disagreement concerning John Mark, Barnabas' cousin. In Acts 15 and 36, because John Mark, Barnabas' cousin, left Pamphylia when it got heated on the mission. You see, Paul didn't gloss over the fact that John Mark left them high and dry. He didn't. We're talking about greatness right now. We must address the issues no matter the relationship. Barnabas and Paul had 15 years strong in doing the things of the Lord and walking in the Lord and evangelizing from city to city, town to town. But Paul had to question Barnabas about John Mark. You see, because on their second trip, they was going to go around and do the same thing again. And he said, you remember what John Mark did. It's the words that they had a sharp disagreement, meaning that they had words. They had words. Look, he's not coming with us. I don't care what you say. I don't care if it's your cousin, your mother's brother's son. He's not coming with us. So they did. They had a disagreement and they split. Barnabas went to Cyprus and Silas and Paul went on the journey. You see, your greatness is always, like I said, it's going to be ugly. You know, that was an ugly disagreement. You know, I've been with you for 15 years, but I can't allow you to take me off of what the Lord is calling me to do. I can't allow you to deter me because you have feelings for this person who left us high and dry. Now, later on, Paul does go back and uplift John Mark. And John Mark also came back.